I do agree. And one of the questions that why I will be the race. Listen, this is, we all as we are doing it. And I hope people that will belong to the SLPP also will agree with me that side. Because if we all serious about corruption, charity begins at home. You know, we all for speak up and tell the president the truth or say, hey, but listen, you say you defend the corruption, but it's high business secrets where you are somebody, or now you and the person no more know which one they talk about your assets and all that kind of thing. That's not acceptable. You know, if that the reason that will make you appoint her, then really that's a bad reason for appointing him. I am not going to make that an indication. Because really, I'm not getting any evidence for who say he appoints her for that reason. You know, suffice it to say though that what can happen after you appoint the man and the way we declare assets not to be correct with that, and that is not transparent. You know, that worries me.
All right, sir. Of course we need to make progress, and I want to take you, of course, not far away from the subject matter, which is the SLPP government stands accused of many constitutional violations. And again, I talk about your skating attack recently, where we not even begin on that yet, but we just begin to see the beginnings of that skating attack where you make. So they stand of many constitutional violations. Prominent among them in the earlier stages of the government is the restriction of people's movements. And sometimes, I know you talked about the Magna Carta at some point, you know, yeah, and we rules-based system, how we attach to the English common law going back to many centuries ago. And sometimes, you know, the forced labor way the SLPP government use, especially so when it comes to cleaning exercise. Are you of the same view, sir, that the reference made in Article 18 and 19 subsections, one of the constitutions, were violated?
Yes. I still hold on to that view. I will tell you why. Listen, you know, me and the one policy, we place a lot of premium on human rights and the rights of the people that move freely and not, you know, force anybody for perform labor or, you know, for perform. Yeah, that is simply, it is not only wrong, you're unfortunate, and it is inhuman. This is the 21st century now. What baffles me is do we really need to declare cleaning Saturday to clean the cities? And most people, when I talk about the violations for movement of people and forced labor, I remember who people that talk say me they against Saturday cleaning. No, I am not. I am not against Saturday cleaning. The question what they ask is this though: a government need to declare Saturday cleaning for clean the city? I mean, how come we live in America now? No, at no point in time, somebody, no president, not get the power, because you don't, now your office, the White House, they declare, say, today the clean is Saturday, every American can come on at home and clean. But how come their cities are clean? So, listen, you just need to know how to govern a country, then you know what you need to do to clean your cities. You don't need to force citizens to clean your cities. That's what I am against. A government way serious, you put a plan together to clean your cities, you buy the trucks, you buy recycling equipment, you fend the land, so you don't be thing before you clean your city. You know, they force citizens to go clean the city when are you we elect to let you run the country, right? You know, you want to run for the president, at the same time, you want force me for not help you for let you run the country. I just think that's wrong. So I still hold on to that opinion.
So therefore, the president is clearly in violation of his constitutional duty and towards the citizens of the republic.
Yes, I do agree. Maybe try to give municipalities or municipal councils, the city councils all over the country, let it give them the responsibility for letting them clean their city. And I mean, we let them have a job that EU job as president is to facilitate, to make sure it happens, it supervises, it provides the resources so this exercise will happen and it not for affect any citizen in right to move or talk or work. Nothing working happens seamlessly. Citizens are not going to even notice. But you can't stop a whole country on a whole day, everybody sit down because you want to clean the city. I mean, that's a violation. Nobody, no civilized country does that anymore.
Section 53, subsection 1 of the Constitution says the use of executive order is a necessary requirement for extreme situations. If the national constitution, acts of parliament and regulations are all available and there is no threat to our democracy, I speak within the context of section 53, sir, there are no threats to our democracy as implied by this particular section, which is 53 of the constitution, subsection 1, Why do you think this president has resorted to the use of executive orders, if I can add to that, rampantly?
Well, I can only attempt to answer from what Timmy feels. I think he believes that governing by issuing orders and decrees is the easiest and fastest way for let be accomplished waiting in thinking and in mind. Well, you know, listen, true governance doesn't work that way. First of all, governance is always by consensus. You get to be reasonable, you get to also consider other people their interests. That's all the thing time. There is nothing we be in governance way for always happening with lightning speed. You know what happened with lightning speed. So I guess that the president, even when there is no emergency, he tries to create an emergency so he can issue an order. That is not how to govern. I mean, if you govern a country by just issuing orders and decrees and this and this and this and this and that, you know, pretty soon it becomes a police state. And you know, now we have a constitution now. You know, how can we have a police state when we are now a constitutional democracy? I don't think it's necessary.
So are there any mechanisms or way of mounting a legal challenge to these orders, sir? Those of us that don't agree the way you've categorized it, you know, yeah, that there has to be freedom and people need to understand and enjoy those freedoms. It's not by force. It's not a military junta, if you like. Are there ways for people to challenge these kind of orders?
Listen, the constitution, the every citizen, the power, when they violate your human rights, you have a right to go to the Supreme Court and challenge it. You know, it's in every democracy now, that's so it works. So everybody, we all get rights on the challenge. If the president exceeds the authority, you, number one, as I always do, we let him, we support him, now we president. But when he exceeds the authority and we think, say, he wants to begin to assume powers we cannot get, it is our job to remind him, number one. Number two, you know, when many citizens can take this up to the Supreme Court and challenge the authority, and luckily now, in fact, to get beyond that one day, people, as far as human rights concerned, people can go as far as the ECOWAS court and challenge them. So I think that the safety nets and mechanisms, and whether or not citizens are able to take, they get to get the guns or take down the up is another issue.
Thank you. Just a few months ago, when the Sierra Leone People's Party, of course, ladies and gentlemen, for those of you in the chat room and those of you who are going to listen to this later, we are speaking to lawyer Abubakar Sidique Kalokoh. He is a senior member of the one-time government of the All People's Congress, never really participated, I believe, directly, so I stand to be corrected, but he's still a senior member of that party, which is now effectively in opposition. He is a barrister at law and is a member, a senior member, not only a member, a senior member of the legal bar. And most of the questions that we are asking, of course, is pertaining to legal issues and, well, most of the other people that see this or are in cahoots or in bed or support or are members of the ruling government, because they are the members of the ruling government or are the party in governance. So we seem to be questioning most of their actions. And today we've got Lawyer Kalokoh here. Lawyer Kalokoh, some time ago, lest we forget, these processes tend to come back to haunt us. The APC has got a majority in parliament. Some time ago, when parliament was declared open, 68 members of that parliament were expelled from the parliament. Expelled in the sense, no eternity, if you like, but temporarily they were expelled. Now, the minority that were left in that parliament managed to elect the speaker of the parliament. Sir, with all of your experience and your know-how, how can you explain this process? What really went wrong and how can this be averted in the future? And what is the future consequence for such a thing that happened in the parliament?
I think, you know, it's very unfortunate that it happened that way in the parliament that assembly. You know, it's very unusual. This is one of the very, very, very few and extreme cases where I see a minority parliament gets to elect a speaker. It doesn't get to happen very often these days. In the old days, we politics are just a brutal, you know, anything can pass game here, it don't happen. So it's unfortunate. I think What thing we as politicians need to do is to reduce incidents of political gamesmanship, especially when we try to push them to the extreme. So the point that we're willing to sacrifice decency and rules just so we able to get the agenda. I did not think that was right. You know, really, it just not look good no more for the ruling government, because not today that the majority they go inside, bring pull people there by force, or they try to file cases that Supreme Court when they say they were just dummy cases where they file only because they want to remove them people and they say they not vote, so they will elect as speaker. I mean, number one, that's disingenuous. Number two, it is actually inappropriate for let any government try for trick on our citizens into doing a thing like that. You play games on the people so that you go put your policy where you want to make a speaker. It's not done anymore. I mean, in the interest of democracy, one thing where every citizen gets to learn is every time you don't win, you should be able to accept the fact that not you win. This meeting the effect of this government. If you not get the majority, if you able accept the fact say not to you get the majority, now APC get the majority. If you've been found the other way around, I would have said the same thing to the APC. As I do every so often, when they are wrong and they cross the line, I tell them. But in this particular case, it's very unfortunate and it's wrong. So therefore, you know, without hesitation, I condemn that.
With actions of this kind, which you've just described as disingenuous, inappropriate, outright wrong, what will this government do, whether in good faith, that will not be questionable?
Well, we have a lot more time left for letting govern the country. And they always pray for, say, let reason prevail over emotion. And we will continue for praying for the president and the leadership for letting them realize, say, this is now a democracy. There is no way any government can rule Sierra Leone now without consensus. So they urge the president and the new government to realize, say, by itself, you know, we will govern the country the way it wants. You know, there has to be checks and balances. There is nothing he can do about that. Now, so no more the system set up. And, you know, that's a recipe that one day for then we also even for question what he did do, so that in the best interest of we all, we could work as a team, we could work as a country, we could work as a family for let the country go before. But for things, say, it will go on only the way we in want. Inside parliament, you know, get the majority today, but he get for force away because now so he wants, and that one day, you know, get for be good for the country.
Yeah, but Lawyer Kalokoh, so what is the answer? It's not going to be good for the country. It sounds very ominous, but then it continues to do so, because when we talked earlier on at this interview about in proclamation, the way they make, in rule by edict, in rule by decree, this is what it amounts to, and that's not going to stop. So yes, it's not going to be good for the country, but why wait until it is no longer good? What can be done now, or if there are things that can be done now, what can be done now to avert this?
I encourage every Sierra Leonean for speak up in a respectful way. Because also, now we leader, so now we, now the president of the country will get to be respectful. At the same time, you know, the country not belong to us. It belongs to we all. Keeping quiet when you do see something wrong, that also is unconscionable. I don't know how some Sierra Leoneans and they go sleep. Then they see wrong things, they know they talk up. Nobody, you know, they ask for letting disrespect the president. But when the president wrong, ask me to do our thing, you know, say something. Let me try for correct them so I can go wrong. Sometimes, you know, it can be said that they violate certain things, maybe because they don't know. Right? So it is our duty as citizens for let me stand up in a non-violent way, in a non-threatening way, and tell his government that you're wrong and we know what to like this. Beyond that one day, they can't be talk this no more. I think we'll get to reach a point where citizens need to stand up and challenge some of these things in the courts. Because actually, in a civilized way that one day, for there in a democracy, when the president begin to exceed the authority, for there you challenge along with the stop arm. And the third thing we are for us is parliamentarians. Now that make we elect now. It is also your job, even if you belong to the SLPP. When you see the president exceed in authority, if you go too far, it is your job or your duty as a Sierra Leonean, a good citizen, to remind the president when a leader of you, your party, for tell us if you don't exceed the authority. If you are a set of the commission of inquiry, you don't begin to pass certain rules when you don't get the power for pass. I expect the SLPP government for hold that to task. If not, would they call on members of parliament, Dr. Yunkela, other people, the way the APC government stand up and say something? It is your job for them to correct the president when he begins for exceeding authority. And also the courts, the chief justice, the judicial system, for get the nerve for stand up and protect the democracy. This is also good for President Madabio. If this democracy endure, it will endure to the benefit of the president and in beginning and in grand beginning, we will come after.
All right. Thank you so much, sir. Former government officials, they feel victimized under the